Well, here we go. We are so excited today. We're going to celebrate Barbara's birthday with getting as close to Barbara as you can get. Mini Barbara, Lauren Frost. Welcome to the show, Lauren.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Oh, we're so excited to see you. I think this is going to make everyone so happy to get to see you after all these years.
I love it. I love this little birthday celebration. This is fun.
And it's so fun to see you all grown up and a regular adult person these
A
days.
full-on adult. Here we are.
Yeah.
It happens.
How old were you when you first did the Timeless concerts with Barbra?
I was, well, the process started. I was four, or sorry, I was 13 when the whole process started.
Right.
I auditioned at 13, but then I was, the whole thing lasted from when I was 13 to 8 or 15.
I mean, it would be okay if the answer is no, but did you know who Barbra was at 13? Because,
Oh yeah, no, I
okay.
really did. I did. I knew she was an icon. I grew up watching Funny Girl and listening to her music, and it just made it all the more special. I mean, I actually, since I was a little kid, was compared to her. People would say that I looked like her. So when this came about, it was just kismet.
Right.
But I mean, like, that's easy to say, but you actually really did look like her, and then you got to play her. So that is insane. Like, for, like, so, you know, let's just jump right in. Like, how the heck did that ever happen?
The stars aligned. I had begged my parents to take me to LA to audition for TV and film. I grew up a theater kid in Chicago, doing professional theater there, and I always just wanted to entertain. And so they took me to LA for the first time, the summer of 99. So I was between middle school and high school, and it was just like, hey, let's try it out. Let's, get an agent. Let's try auditioning. And that summer was when I auditioned for the Streisand tour. So it kind of catapulted me. It's really crazy to think about the coincidences,
Right.
that me to that audition, the timing of it all. And so the story goes, when I got the call for the audition, it was put in the breakdowns as a pilot because it was a top secret project, I'm sure
Oh.
that Barbara and her people didn't want like a bunch of crazy people coming out of the woodwork to play Minnie Streisand. So it was like under wraps, So I thought I was just auditioning for a pilot. I went to one of the rehearsal studios in Burbank for the casting. I sang a song, and I had that like kid confidence where, like, I didn't know the I didn't understand the pressure of it. I was just
What
having
song did you sing?
someone to watch over me.
Oh.
It was just one of my favorite songs at the time. I grew up listening to jazz and blues. My dad's a musician, and I was heavy in my little Gershwin era. And I thought I would sing that. And the casting director was Greg Smith, who grew to be a dear friend. When I sang the song, Greg left the room, and he was holding his chest and had tears in his eyes. And my mom's a nurse, so she thought this man was having a heart attack. She was like, "Are you okay?" And he goes, he was like, "I just need a moment." And he was taking deep breaths, and he said to her, like under his breath, "I found her. We found her." About me, like I wouldn't have even known that if he hadn't run out and my mom thought he was having a heart attack. So, it's just a fun little tidbit about the audition. And then the process, was such that I had to audition several other times, but I was ready to start high school, so I had to go back to Illinois. And in those days, for the callbacks, we were getting bits and pieces of information. Like with each callback, it was like, I think this is for Streisand, and in those days, my dad had like a camcorder. There wasn't Zoom callbacks. There wasn't, so we
Right.
were doing it old school on a VHS and sending them tapes. And oh gosh, what can I tell you?
Did you have to sing You'll Never Know?
I did. So with each callback, like I said, we were getting more information. So at one point they asked me to learn You'll Never Know and sing it. And thankfully my dad's a musician, so he had a keyboard and we plucked it out and I learned it. And I remember specifically they sent us a piece of sheet music and they had whited out Streisand's name. And my dad holding it up to a light, like trying to figure out, is it her? And it was. And we're like, oh my God, what is this? You know? And then all of that led to them flying me back out to LA to go meet her and sing for her and Marvin Hamlisch. And at that point, I know, right? At that point, it was down to me from Chicago, a girl from New York, and a girl from LA.
That wasn't at her house, was it? Or were you in a rehearsal studio?
Oh, it was. They picked me up in a little town car, and my mom and I went to Malibu.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it was
crazy.
Pretty incredible.
Were the other two girls there, or you were by yourself?
I didn't meet them at that call. I think I met one of the girls because there was a second callback. I just remember being in an elevator with another young girl and my mom and Marvin. So I don't know if that was like the final call, but yeah, it's kind of blurry, but do you remember going to her house? And Marvin, I loved Marvin so much. I called him Uncle Marvin, you know, he was so good to me. And he really, my first time meeting him really put me at ease. You know, he was such a jokester and like, he was so disarming, you know? So I walk into grandma's cottage at Barbara's house and he's at the piano and he's like, let's rehearse it, you know? And I sang it with him and he was like, okay, great. And he's like, let's bring her in. And I remember these like, French doors open and it was like a movie moment, like the breeze picked up and Barbra walks in, her hair flowing, you know what I mean?
Wow.
She was just so normal, like so down to earth. She was like, oh hi, I'm Barbra. And I was like, I know, I think I said I know. And then she's like, okay, we're gonna sing. And I started singing with Marvin and she's like, she was sitting down and then she got up and she got up all excitedly and was like, okay. And then she pulls out a little model of the stage.
Oh boy.
So, and she's like, you know, so I'll be here and you'll be here. And I'm all the while looking like back and forth to the people in the room at Marvin and her. And I'm thinking like, did I get it? Like, so yeah, that was that magical moment.
Oh my gosh. So did you, in that time, did you listen to You'll Never Know from Just for the Record from her at 13? And did you try to be that person?
I listened to it, but I wasn't trying to mimic her or sound like her or, yeah, I was just singing like myself. And she never asked me to change my voice either, you know, which I found interesting.
If there is some other way to prove that I love you, I swear I don't know how. You'll never know if you don't know now.
How was it, I'm going to forget the lady's name, but I think Alec Led and the woman that played your mother.
Randy
Heller. How was that being part of that Barbra ensemble?
Oh, we were like three peas in a pod because, you know, we were always in rehearsals together. We traveled together. You know, even after the tour, when my mom and I were back in LA and I was back auditioning and working on other projects, I stayed at Randy's house. Like we house sat for her and she really was, love Randy. Love her so much. Yeah, we were all kind of like, holy shit, what are we doing here?
You know? Amazing.
Yeah, so it was cool to experience it with those two.
Just do what I tell you. Listen to him, Barbra.
Well, don't you think it's a little bit long?
All right, let's rehearse the ending. Here's
stop,
how it goes.
Stop fidgeting.
Pay attention.
I remembered her from Karate Kid.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Yeah, the mom in Karate Kid.
Because it blew my mind the first time I saw Timeless that I was like, she's kind of a big actress. I mean, of course, any job for Barbra is a big deal, but I mean, she was like a working actress to do that, which I always thought was a good get.
Totally. And she loved it. I mean, she loved her character. We both loved the costumes and yeah. And because she was so established, it was also really cool for me to be around her and learn from her just as much as Barbra and anyone else. I mean, everyone a part of this project was like, obviously it's Streisand. So they were the best in their category, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Now, I know you guys did extensive rehearsals and I think you had dress rehearsals.
Yeah.
Getting to opening night though, you know, when we watch it on the DVD, I was not there. Sorry.
But, well, the tickets were quite pricey.
Well, yes, they were.
You had to get to Las Vegas too, and you know.
Yeah.
But watching the video, it just seems like there was this tremendous roar of an audience. Do you recall? Were you nervous?
Again, I think I had that young kid confidence where you're like, it. Truly probably didn't even register how many people were in the audience.
Wow.
You know, I do remember the moment of, so in the opening number after Something's Coming, right? I ran off the stage and I had two security guards running with me, like through the MGM Grand and the audience, I mean, they went crazy, you know? So I was like riding that wave of that rush. And I went backstage and my parents were in my dressing room and they're like, you did it. And I was like, I said to them, that was the biggest rush of my life. You know, my young 14-year-old.
right. So far.
Yeah, exactly.
Tell us about the little magic trick where, you know, hide, like, you know, and it's so on the video, it is so well done that sometimes I wonder, like, did they fake that for the video?
Could be. Who knows? There's something to any day. I will know right away, soon as it shows. It's Nick, I'm kind of.
So cool. We rehearsed that so many times. And Savion Glover was Father Time.
Yes. Brother Time.
And he was amazing to me too. Like I can't say enough how lucky I was as a kid to be in such company and such professionals. And my first experience working with that level of celebrity, and everyone was so kind, you know, because I was a kid actor. It could have gone really south. They could have been terrible to me and I would have not pursued this business, you know? So he was another wonderful, wonderful person to work with. But anyway, so yeah, he had that big cloak and we rehearsed it so many times and it was so heavy. I remember him because it was full of mirrors, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And the trick was involving hydraulics. So I had a little elevator that I came out of and yeah.
So you went down and Barbra came up?
Yeah.
Fascinating.
And I had to like scurry off the elevator and she had to come on and we, you know, it was wild.
It's
so cool. And then I have to share a story with you because you matter to me and my family because I've loved Barbra since I was a little kid.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, my kids, they weren't loving Barbra.
Yeah.
But my daughter loved you in Timeless. Her favorite Barbra song is Something Coming because you sing it.
Oh my God.
And so when you're off to the side and then the mom says,
Bride is coming.
Barbra.
Coming, because something's coming. Me and my daughter still do that. Like, that's something that we talk, and she loved you as a little kid. Barbra, she wasn't, you know, she'd watch some stuff, but she always wanted to watch your songs.
That's so special. I'm thank you for sharing that. That makes me feel so good.
Yeah. So I just wanted you to know, you probably think like, oh, everybody, like, here, everyone cares about Barbra. My daughter couldn't care less about Barbra. It was you she loved.
You know what? In all these years, no one's given me that feedback. So that's so sweet. Thank you.
Well, and it's really true. Like, I interview people all the time. She could care less. When I told her I was interviewing you, she's like so excited.
Oh, that's
she's
so
like, Barbra, sweet. Eh.
It's just, you know, it's funny too. It's like, if I didn't do this tour, I wouldn't have gotten the Disney Channel show.
Right.
Did that come after this tour?
It did. So
you're talking Even Stevens now, right?
Yeah. And, you know, I was, you know, before logging on to talk to you guys, I was thinking about, like, how did this really affect the rest of my trajectory? And when I auditioned for the Disney Channel show, I just auditioned in my regular speaking voice, and then they saw Streisand on my resume and they said, can you do it in that, like, Brooklyn accent? And I did, and then that character was born, and that's how I got cast, you know. So talking about, you know, your daughter seeing me in that,
right,
you know, led to this, where other kids grew up watching me on that show. So isn't life funny? I don't know.
No, it really is. Everything leads to itself. And one of the things that I was curious about is, I think that our work ethic is what propels us forward when we're artists. Yeah. Like, people think that it's so easy, but, you know, it's not. You have to do so much work. What did you learn from Barbra, and how have you taken that into the rest of your career?
Watching her in rehearsals and how she treats everyone around her was so beneficial to me. She's such a professional. She's very collaborative. You could tell that she trusts her people. She's extremely loyal to who she works with. It was really apparent that she valued every person, their talents and the part that they played. And I think I've taken that with me going forward. And and again, just, she's an icon, and she, you know, she didn't have to stop and ask everybody, how's your day, how's your kids, you know, whatever. Like, I think that was really cool. I think it's a great lesson in loyalty and humility.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. And I love that she's always been herself, you know, and, you know, she, being a young person and getting compared to her, you know, it's like, I am unique looking. She's unique looking, you know, but to have an idol like that, I think really helped me, like, in my confidence as a young girl, you know. Mm-hmm. I am beautiful in a unique way, you know, just like Barbra. So yeah. I think as a young person, that was really important.
And then you guys took the show on the road.
Right.
And you went to Melbourne and Sydney.
Yeah.
Did your parents come? Did you travel as a family?
They did. Yeah. They were able to come. So for the whole process, you know, my mom had to take a leave of absence from her work so that she could be, you know, I was a minor on set and doing all that. So she was with me. And then my dad was able to come too. I'm an only child. I don't think any of this could have really been possible if, you know, I had siblings, quite frankly, because they had to be with me. But yeah, going to Australia was incredible. We all sort of traveled together. So I was on the flight with my parents and Alec and Randy. And I just have such great memories from being in Australia and getting to see the city with them, and so many little things, you know. It was just such a great experience. You know, we played football stadiums there. So going from the MGM Grand to these football stadiums, and one thing I remember in particular, it was raining out at one of the shows, and it was an outdoor venue. And Barbra came out in, she was supposed to come out in this beautiful gown, or her, I think it was her pants set. Either way, she didn't want to get it wet in the rain. So she showed up on stage in like wearing all black and what she arrived to the show in. And one of the grips had a Australian hat on and like an outback hat, and they took it off his head and put it on hers. And then they found I don't know how they found a matching outfit for me on the spot. So the audience looked, and when I came out, still was her mini, you know. It was such a cool moment.
So you also got to do Papa and Piece of Sky, which is such a that's such a moment when you guys are turning and all of that. What can you tell us about performing that with Barbra?
I just didn't want to mess it up.
Because
was like,
it is a lot of timing.
yes, and I just wanted to make sure I got my harmonies right, you know, and the timing of us turning with the huge LED screens, like it was an epic moment, you know. But I really didn't know how epic until I saw it on the DVD, you know, because I'm on stage, I'm not seeing all of the moving parts.
I can hear you, Papa. I can see you, Papa. I can feel you, Papa. Watch me
incredible. And I remember like ascending on those staircases that they built into the
those
stage.
staircases that like went like they it became a staircase, it was a ramp and it became a
Yeah,
staircase.
it grew into a staircase.
Well, yeah, that is on somewhere. That's
Yes.
the end. And it kind of seems like you and Barbra die at the end and ascend to heaven. It's kind of
I
a strange,
know.
and every time I see it, I feel like, are they did Barbra die at the end
A
of
little
this thing?
spooky.
Yeah. Like you ascend into heaven.
I haven't thought of it that way, but yeah, it can be a little spooky.
I don't think you're supposed to think of it that way, but sometimes it comes to me. But I mean, you were in some really big numbers, like belting it out. That has to be so fun as a 13-year-old or 14-year-old just to scream at the top of your lungs somewhere and
Totally.
have that reaction.
Yeah, and the size of that orchestra, you know, I think it was a 64-piece orchestra. Getting to sing with those musicians, like insane. One thing I remember her telling me is she doesn't warm up. And I would be in my dressing room doing my little vocal scales. And one day at rehearsal, she pulled me aside. She's like, "Lauren, what do you mean you warm up?" And I was like, "Well, you have to warm up." And she's like, "I never warm up." I was like, "Okay." She said, Sing to me, like, what do you do?" And I sang her a little scale, and she was just kind of like, "Huh, okay." She just doesn't do it. She just like goes from
Oh my
speaking, have a
gosh.
little bit of tea, and you know, just comes out of her. It's crazy.
Wow. So then we get to still on Timeless. We get to the final concerts, the ones in Los Angeles and New York. That's what they were called at the time, the final concerts. Any memories of that? I've heard a recording of the New York one and the audience is ecstatic. What do you recall?
I remember just being thrilled to be at the Staples Center and at Madison Square Garden, like walking down the halls of Madison Square Garden and seeing all like the people that have performed there before, or all the sports stuff. Clearly, I'm not a sports person.
That's all right. Neither are we. You're in the right
If
spot.
you're in the right company. It was incredible. Just bopping around New York was so cool. And Yeah, the sizes of these venues were massive. I think I was just kind of excited and in disbelief that we're getting to play these venues. Oh, I do have a great memory from Madison Square Garden. So the trumpet player in the orchestra was Lou Soloff, and he was another dear friend. My dad's a trumpet player, and he got along great with Lou, and Lou shared an incredible moment for my dad where he let him sit in his chair in the orchestra and play his trumpet, like in between rehearsals. It was a down moment, and so my dad got to sit and play Madison
Wow.
Square Garden too, and I just thought that was so sweet.
Yeah, I love that. Who did you get to meet? Because I mean, there's so many stars come to see
Oh
Barbra.
my God,
Did you get to meet
everybody,
anyone exciting?
everyone. I mean, like, looking out into the audience from the stage, you know, you only see the first couple rows of seats, and in those first couple rows are like Barbara Walters, Oprah, Rosie O'Donnell, like it's all the celebrities, you know. I met Tom Hanks and his wife Rita, John Travolta, like literally at the time, every A-lister there was at these concerts or backstage, and then just becoming friends with Barbara. You know, I was invited to Kelly Preston's baby shower, and you know, at Elizabeth Taylor's home, and like
Oh my God.
I'm in the bathroom washing my hands, and there's like white diamonds perfume there. I'm like, what is my life? It was surreal. My mom and I got to go on a cruise on Donna Karan's boat with Barbara, and I mean, it a lot of it feels like a dream.
Yeah, I mean, I always think that it's interesting when you have this moment when you're young and then you've got the rest of your life. Like, did you
Right?
struggle to like put it behind you and become a natural? You seem like a normal human being. You haven't yelled at us yet. You haven't thrown anything. I mean,
Therapy is a wonderful thing.
agreed.
Yeah, you know, I it's it if I'm honest, it has been a journey. Like, I think it really could have gone south if I hadn't put the work in on myself and had the family I have that keeps me grounded. But truly, there was a lot of comparison, you know. There was a lot
Sure.
of talk. There was a lot of, oh, she's the next Streisand, or what's she gonna do next? And there were down times where I felt like a failure, like, oh, I'm not her, or I didn't do this, that, or the other, and what does that say about me? But you know, everybody's got their own path, and I have a great perspective on it now. There were some years where I felt the pressure to be this thing, or you know.
Right. Thank you so much for being honest about it. You know, it's something that I struggle with because I'm an author and you have a book come out and you have that 2 weeks where you're on the radio and you're on here and everybody and you're signing books. And
Right.
then, you know, the next week you're mowing the grass and you know,
And
you
it's
go
like
back
cricket.
to life.
But you
It's
know what?
hard.
So much of that is the nature of the entertainment industry too. You know, I'm still acting, I'm still auditioning. You just got to ride those highs and lows. You know, it's kind of the nature of the beast. But yeah, I think it's important to be honest about it. You know, I'm a big advocate for therapy. I know I joke about it, but like, yeah, it's a thing. It's important to take care of your mental health too.
I saw you on your co-star Christy Carlson Romano's
Oh
podcast with you guys sort of bonding over your experience on the Disney show. And I just thought you guys came off so lovely, you know, just sort of like adults as you are now, talking about the past and having processed a lot of it.
honestly, I can't think about it too hard or I'll burst into tears, but like that was also a really great experience to see where how far she's come, and as you know, as grown into herself and as a mom and running this podcast business. Like, I loved getting to be pun intended, vulnerable with her, because that's the name of her podcast. But
right.
Yeah, it was really great to reconnect. And she's put in a lot of work on herself too. I think you have to if you're raised in this business.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, tell the fans that know you as Mini Me Barbra or Young yeah. Barbra. Tell them, I mean, I think Barbara's song Secondhand Rose may
oh, it's... may,
my cat is on me, sorry. It okay. applies to you these days. Besides, you know, doing voiceovers and acting, and you have your hand in so many things, to update everybody on what you're doing these days.
Sure. Yeah, it's funny. I've been listening to Barbara's book as I'm like steaming clothes and doing things. So basically I'm like I said, I'm still acting. But along the way I've found wardrobe styling, and I have always loved vintage clothes. And so these days that's what I'm doing alongside acting. I do wardrobe styling for commercials or costume design for films and things like that. I also just got the keys to my own little space that I'm doing by appointment vintage sales. So I'm
where's
very,
it going to be?
It's in Atwater Village in LA. So it's between Silver Lake and Los Feliz. If you want to book appointment and shop some vintage, you can. I just like,
nice.
Do you have a website, or let's promote it? Do you have a website for people, or how could someone who's, and actually I'm going to be in LA in April. So I'll come, I'd love to.
Yeah, it's my own little happy place. I'm like surrounded by clothes and I love it. Yeah, you could just book appointment with me through Instagram at this point. Like just send me a direct message. I'm working on the website to get an online booking going, but
tell people your Instagram.
It's just my name, at Lauren Frost.
And your Instagram is fabulous. You definitely serve a lot of looks that are fabulous.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
and this is you're in vintage today?
Yes. Like pretty much every day I'm in vintage, but yeah, this is just a little crochet number. Yeah, so I've been listening to Barbara's book and merchandising and getting ready to open this studio. And I just love that how she talks about clothes too. And it's just not lost on me that we have these parallels. And I recently reconnected with her over vintage. She was curious about my collection and I sent her some photos of things that would work for her. And it's just wonderful, you know? It's like
that has to blow your mind a little bit, because one thing to help her when you were a little kid, but now as a grown up with your passion, you're helping her.
Totally. Or just getting to chat and connect on a personal level about something we both love is kind of wild. Yeah.
Well, her book, she remembers just about every meal and every outfit.
Oh, right? I love it.
Right.
This woman right. loves food.
Absolutely.
Food and yeah. fashion, like a girl after my own heart, you know? Yeah.
Another yeah. thing that you got to do for Barbra was sing for her at the AFI tribute.
Oh, yeah.
And that you, she really seemed to be surprised by it. So can you tell us how that came to be and how you learned that pretty complex song?
It was very hush-hush. It was meant to be a surprise. And we pulled it off, you know? It was pretty cool that like all of her people were keeping it quiet, even when I was like going to rehearsals with Marvin and Alan and Marilyn Bergman. And they wrote that song just for that day, just for that mm-hmm. tribute. So yeah, I was going to rehearsals at the Bergman's house.
Wow.
And it was fun because they were sort of writing it alongside me. So I would sing a lyric and they would go, oh, that sounds great. Let's change it to this. Or, you know, I was watching them work in rehearsals.
Amazing.
Yeah. And then going back to the costumes, it's like, I remember everything I wore during Streisand because she was just as passionate about the wardrobe as, you know, I was excited about it. She sourced some of the vintage for the tour, you know, or she was so particular about the socks I wore because it was so important to her when she was little in the recording studio, or just in general, her socks were always falling down because she had funny legs. And so she had the costume designer like stretch them out so that I could be pulling them up. And For the AFI, I wore this beautiful, like 1930s silks, layered, you know, it was just every part of it was special. I love how detail-oriented she was and is.
Well, and
And
I just happened to rewatch it, and Barbara just loves everything you do, and she's reacting to every joke, and
yeah.
it lands so well.
Yeah.
And like that's has to be incredible. And I don't
And
remember
then
the timeline. When how long ago was that? I'm sorry.
Marvin gave you flowers when you finished.
Yeah. I loved him. Miss
Yeah.
him.
He's very sweet. I met him once, and just like you said, he, I think went to great pains to make me feel comfortable. And who am I? He was a very sweet man.
He's just a great, yeah, he was a wonderful man. And yeah, even, you know, if I found myself in New York for auditions or whatever, I'd always meet up with Marvin and he would take me to lunch and check in on me. And, you know, he introduced me to the black and white cookies. You know, that's like such a New York
Oh
thing.
my God, I love those. Those are my favorite.
You have to have these, and, you know, so, but, and yeah, going back to what you were saying, Barbara's reactions, like, she was always so lovely to me. And I think that really shows that like, she had like this maternal energy, you know. But performing it, I was like, oh, good, she likes it, you know. Oh, yay, she was surprised. Oh, and
One
that,
of
like,
my favorite photos from the book is this one with you guys. That's very sweet.
yeah, I remember that photo shoot. She had that giant green cape, and I was just sort of like swimming in it, you
Well,
know.
it became, well, actually, it's behind me. Yeah, it became
Yeah.
the cover of our book.
Oh, cool. Yeah. It's a great photo. She and again, she was very involved in that wardrobe too. Yeah.
So, has this followed you your whole life? Because I think that's what's interesting is sometimes when you're a child actor, then people don't realize it's you. Or do people always say, "Oh my gosh, you were the little girl who played
Yeah.
Barbara," or did they not know?
So yes, it's followed me. If people, her fans are incredible. Like her fans have kept up with me and they've always been supportive of it, whatever I'm doing. Yeah, so they will remind me. They love it. And
Totally.
if people who aren't Streisand fans, I mean, I still get compared to her to this day, just in looks or whatever. Or like, has anyone ever told you? I'm like, yep, they have.
As a matter of fact.
As a matter of fact, yeah, exactly. Or you know, just because I was so public as a kid, I get a lot of what high school did you go to, or just you know, where are you from? And then I have to go, oh well, do you know Barbra Streisand? Like I played her, and then they're like, oh my God, that was you. So yeah, I get it. It comes up, and it's funny to me how she follows me, you know. Even to this day, when I'm like at estate sales or digging through thrift stores, there'll be like a picture of Streisand or like, and I'll be like, oh hey, how you doing? See you. Yeah.
You've got your own music too. You recorded a few albums and EPs like Words for the Birds and the Oakdale Sessions.
Yeah.
What kind of how would you describe the kind of music that you have ended up recording and enjoying?
Well, I would refer to my Words for the Birds album as like as angstiest as I could get in my 20s.
Okay.
I mean, it's funny because it's not angsty at all. It's quite pop of a record, but yeah, I still sing, I still write. I just do it for myself these days. But yeah, that early songwriting was really important to me. It was how I was expressing myself artistically at the time. And I liked lyrics were always really important to me. I liked the storytelling of the song.
Is there any music right now that's really you're very passionate about? Is there an artist or an album right now that you love listening to?
Here's a shameless plug. My husband,
Oh.
my husband is a musician. His name is Justin Holsey, and I'm just always impressed with the music he writes.
What kind?
It's how would he describe it? I mean, I guess it's a singer-songwriter category, but it's bigger production. He loves the band Doves, and he comes from the whole like 90s Pearl Jam era.
Okay.
I've learned a lot. My music catalog has expanded.
Totally.
Yeah, I think he's a beautiful songwriter. I think he is a great storyteller. And again, lyrically, it's always a little ambiguous, or you could digest it how it pertains to you. But yeah, I love his work. So check him out.
I think on your Instagram, there's a video of you guys singing together. He's playing guitar, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We were actually in Austin, Texas, visiting our friend's new home, and it was empty, and it's this big old home, and so all the acoustics were insane, you know. It's like wood floors, high ceilings, and I was like, let's sing, let's play. And I sang one of his songs called You and Wine. I love that song.
Well,
Yeah.
we're going to check it
That's
out.
on my Instagram if you're interested.
You
Yeah.
also did a Barbra and Judy thing on your Instagram.
No, wait
So,
a second. That
yeah.
was you
Was
as
she?
Barbra and Judy, right?
Yes. Yeah. It was actually for an audition, and I was like,
Oh.
I'm gonna post this online. It was really fun. I just was doing them as characters for this audition. And
But
that
you
was
were
just
also styled as them as well.
well, listen, I had to style it up, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's where it comes from. Well, I think someone needs to do a biopic about Barbra and you need to play her. Let's make this happen.
I couldn't agree more. Let's do it.
Yeah. You're at the right age where they could make you young and make you old.
I'm down.
Play the whole thing.
Who do we gotta call?
Well, actually, Matt and I could write this script when we really
Okay.
think about this.
Oh my God.
I mean,
Fade
well,
in, Brooklyn.
yeah.
right, we already know we've got the timeless beginning. You
Yeah,
could
who better
CGI
to play
young
it?
you out. Let's just get this done.
I mean, really, what's stopping us? Nothing.
Matt, get Jay and Richard J on the phone and let's get this done.
Seriously, where's Marty?
Okay.
Call him.
Yeah, come on. Well, this was so much fun for us. Thank you for, letting me do one thing my daughter is proud of me for.
Oh, come on.
It finally happened.
Well, tell her I said hello. That I
She's
really love
gonna
that.
die. She's not gonna watch this because she did, none of my children consume anything I did. But I will tell her that you said hello.
Do. Yeah, I would love that.
Lauren, you're a pleasure, and it's
Thank
just so
you.
nice. I think the fans will really enjoy, seeing Lauren of 2024 and
I
catching
hope
up with
so.
you.
And
Yeah.
I'd love to connect too. So anybody can, follow me on Instagram and let's hang out there.
Definitely. And let's support Lauren's new business. And I'm going to contact you about when I'm coming because I'm coming
Yes,
for a book
please.
signing out there in LA for,
Exciting.
oh,
Do you
wait a
have
minute. I
men's
already went.
thrift?
I'm sorry, what?
No, I mostly do women's, but if you need something men's vintage,
Scott.
I know the people. I can connect you.
Well.
Yeah, I do more dresses and gown. I mean, if you want to wear a dress, you can.
Hey,
But
that's right. It's 2024. Don't tell me what I can wear and what I can't. Matt,
you like
shaming me.
sequins,
Yeah,
Matt?
you don't know what my legs look like.
Ah.
I don't.
We're not going to top that ending. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. You guys are lovely. This was so fun.
Thank you so much, Lauren Frost, for being our guest. Thank you, Matt Howe, for co-hosting with me. I'm so lucky to be linked up with Matt. We have always have a good time. And if it's Barbara's birthday, that means it's Matt's book's birthday. This book came out 1 year ago today. They are all sold out. We did a second printing and those sold out of the warehouse. So what other books are out in the world, that's all there are. I can tell you that I only have two cases. So if you want one, you go to tuckerdspress.com and get one of the last ones. They're beautiful. They're full color. The sun is really bright right here, so it's hard to sort of see, but let's get to timeless, which is what we talked about today. You know, if you haven't thought about timeless in a little bit, and then we do all this, and then you're interested in it, then you go to the timeless page, and you check them out. And you read about timeless. You read about Lauren Frost. You know? All in here. So go to Tucker DS Press, get them while they can, because they're just, the price is going to go up because they're going to be collector's edition. I also have a new book coming out. It's called The Last Decade of Cinema. It's going to be out, oh, it's out now, actually. So you can go to Tucker DS Press and pick that up. But you're like, hey, why, Scott? Why would I care? Well, it's about movies from the 90s. And because I'm me, I have a chapter on The Prince of Tides in it. So I cover Barbra's directing and all the film. Matt Howe has a little excerpt in it because we complain about what a dick Mike Wallace is and talk about the difference of men and women directors in the 90s. So check out my new book, The Last Decade of Cinema, at Tucker DS Press. Please go out to laurenfrost.com, follow her at Lauren Frost on Instagram. And if you need some vintage clothing, let's help Lauren out. Listen to some of her music and let's get some plays. You know, it was so nice of her to take time out and come and share these memories and capture them. And she was so honest, and I just thought it was wonderful. I also want to let you know that Matt is working on a paperback edition of the book. It's going to have no pictures in it. It's going to be all text. It's going to be very, you know, nicely priced. So for those of you who said, why would a color $300 photocopy page book be expensive? Welcome to America. But this will be a much cheaper version. It'll have this, but it'll also be updated. He's going through and updating things. He's going to add Yentl and Evergreens and maybe whatever Barbara's working on now. Maybe Streisand sings Sondheim? Let's hope so. I'm talking fast because I feel like I'm going to sneeze at some point and I don't want to do this again. Hold on. I don't think anyone saw. So as always, thank you so much for watching us. When we can get interviews, we'll do more episodes, and please support The Last Decade of Cinema, Barbra Streisand the music, and Matt's upcoming paperback book, which will probably be this fall or early next year, depending on what Barbra has coming up, because we want to keep it current as well as we can. Make sure you follow Barbra Streisand Archives, and thanks for watching, and happy birthday, Barbra!